Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Total Biscuit. I'm here to ask and answer one simple question. WTF is Aces Wild Manic Brawling Action? Well, it involves a decent amount of manic brawling action, as far as I'm concerned, although the Aces part is questionable at best. It's a brawling game, and it's a brawling game that mostly takes place in the air. It encourages you to do aerial combat, although you are not a plane. It's a little strange, to say the least. You'll get the idea when you see it. It's by a company called Culture Attack. They've made a few games before under different names, but this is perhaps their first major commercial release. It's been out for a little while, but it just got on Steam a couple of days back, so I felt it was fairly relevant considering it was top of the Steam list when I made this video. So, let's have a look at it, shall we? Have a look at the options menu first. Well, to get to the options menu, you will initially be very confused because there's no mouse control and the cursor keys don't work. It in fact uses the controls from the game in order to navigate the menu, which is incredibly silly. So WASD will do the job, and then JKL and semicolon, I think, will actually do it. So music volume and SFX volume have their separate sliders. You've also got difficulty going all the way up to Maximus, which is the fifth difficulty level. There's five in total. But the difficulty is also dynamic within the game. So Sassy is the default and is what is recommended, but you can push it up a little bit harder if you so desire. Set resolution options, they are there for the most part. You can press left and right in order to toggle between windowed and full screen. So those all seem to work fairly well without too much of a problem. However, you might wonder, well, how exactly do you get back off the menu? Well, you hit escape and then you hit reset game. There is no actual back button from what I can tell. I've tried almost every button on the keyboard, in fact, if not all of them. And the only thing I could find to get back out of this menu was to hit the reset game button, which takes you right back to the start again, which is fiddly if you're messing with a number of different options. It's a little bit daft, honestly. I think a proper menu system would have been nice. You can also set your controls here, and that will allow you to see pretty much anything. Again, without mouse control, setting the controls is a bit of a pain in the ass. You've got to pretty much set everyone individually. So there's that, which is not so fun, but you'll need to go to that screen because the actual tutorial in the game doesn't tell you what any of the buttons are, which is very, very silly indeed. If you were using a controller, maybe it would make a little bit more sense, but you can play this perfectly fine with a keyboard. In fact, it's designed to be played with a keyboard. It's just they didn't bother to tell you what the buttons were, which is absurd in this day and age. So that's a bit of a black mark against it. I did spend a little bit of time in the tutorial trying to figure out what the hell was what until I figured out the button layout. But you do have to check the options menu under set controls to be able to even play this thing. That is decidedly old school in not a such a pleasant way, in my opinion. I don't think there's any excuse for that in 2014, but there you go. So the game consists of two main modes, Arcade and Boss Rush, which is exactly what you'd expect. Now, strangely enough, it actually lets you play all of the levels from the very beginning. And there's quite a few of them as well. There we go, all the way up to a gallery, which is very Streets of Rage-esque, as you can see. And each of them has five separate areas and a main boss fight. There are sort of mini-boss fights in there as well, which is pretty cool. And they've also, of course, got the high score table. Now, this does have local co-op, so you can bring a second player in, but it does not have online, so that's a little bit disappointing. You don't have to play it in co-op, but it's nice to have that option. Alright, we'll start on stage 2. Seems like a good idea, and kick off on area 1. And I'll show you a couple of different stages, and I'll also show you the higher difficulty levels. Alright, so you've got three characters to choose from here. This is the default guy, Ace Wilder. You've also got Gene Drift and Eagle Morris, who is, well, a ninja. He's got a sword. He's got a fist that is larger than the rest of them. So that seems to do the job. And you can mess around the color as well, if you like, just for the hell of it. Can be quite useful for making the character a little bit easier to see on the screen. Alright, let's rock and roll, shall we? Show you exactly what's going on in Aces Wild. So, we're going to immediately begin with the punching, as you can see right here. So you have a couple of different attacks. You've got Rapid, which is that. You keep hammering this button and it will keep doing combos over and over and over again. You've then got your jump, of course, and you can do any of these combos in the air. In fact, you can actually float around the air for pretty much ever. As you can see there, it's deliberately designed in such a way. You've then got your strong attack or crash attack, which uses part of the wild bar you'll see up the top right there. And you can charge it as well, and you can send it in a particular direction. You can do it without a wild, but it doesn't really do a lot of damage, so it's worth building up your wild bar first in order to make that happen. You then have a dash. Now, this dash can actually home in if you don't press a direction, so that's quite handy. If you hold it down for too long, it starts using up your wild bar. But you can use that dash to directly engage against enemies. Now, you can see these guys are disappearing into the background just to be super awkward there. You also have a dodge, which will dodge pretty much anything in the game from what I've seen so far. It's not so good at dodging stuff that's sustained, obviously. But you can dodge, and you can also perform a counterattack in the process. And then things start to get a little bit silly. Oh, yes. So the aerial combat is the main meat of the game. In fact, it's pretty much all you can do in the game. And you will be attacked by ludicrous numbers of enemies. And this is only on sassy difficulty. The game gets more difficult the more wild you... My apologies. The more wild you actually get on your bar, which is a little bit of a strange way of doing things. The enemies will attack faster, they will attack harder and more aggressively, but with your wild bar charged, you are able to do a bunch of special moves. Now, if you charge your wild bar even higher than that, you unlock the panic bar, which unlocks quite literally a panic button, which you can press. And if you press the panic button, well, you will gain most of your health back, but it will also reset your wild bar and reset your rank. So at the moment, while my wild bar is extremely high, I actually want to drain it a little bit, because if it gets any further, I'm going to end up... Oh yes, hi! Getting into a fairly awkward situation where the enemies will beat my ass into the ground. The rank at the top there dictates your score and your score multiplier. However, the higher the rank, the more difficult it gets. So it's actually quite like God Hand in that respect. When you rank up, it just makes the game more difficult, but it also gives you that higher score multiplier. So, it's a bit of a risk-reward system, but it's compounded by the fact that also the wild bar will increase the aggressive nature of the enemies as well. So, it can be tricky to get the hang of initially. Because you think, oh, my wild bar's high, that's good. You know, I can do lots of special attacks. Yes, it's good, but it also means you're probably going to end up taking more damage and the enemies are going to be more aggressive. So that is something to bear in mind. So you want to frequently use up your wild bar, or indeed dump your wild bar before a particularly dangerous encounter, because otherwise you'll probably end up taking a lot of damage. Now if you hit that panic button, everything resets. So I'm just going to get the panic up here, and then I'll demonstrate that. So I hit the panic button, there we go. Now I'm back to rank 1, so things hit a lot. They just don't hit as hard, they're far less aggressive, they're less dangerous. But I'm also dealing less damage in total. The higher that wild bar gets, and the faster you move, the more damage you end up doing. You'll charge your wild bar faster if you fly quickly across the screen. And, well, you can certainly do that if you get it right. So you can smash enemies all over the place into other enemies, and use those charged attacks in order to deal massive damage. Now, how does the brawling feel? Pretty damn good. And it's mostly because of the crash attacks. Crash attacks send your enemies flying across the screen with a really enjoyable crunch, yeah? There's a huge amount of impact behind them. It's mostly the sound assets that really help that out, as well as a slight pause in the animations whenever you connect to kind of convey the full impact of that blow. So that's very impressive in and of itself. And then, of course, the fact that the enemies fly across the screen, smashing into other enemies, huge amount of visual effects as well as giant damage numbers appearing on the screen. They all help convey the sense that you just hit them with the power of a Norse fucking god. It's pretty damn fantastic. However, what I will say about it is that the basic brawling, that being the rapid attacks, are extremely repetitive. It's just the same combo over and over again. There's not really a lot of variety there. And you need to do those in order to really build up your bar. So, for the most part, you're going to be dodging and flying and dashing and hammering the J key so that you can get your wild bar higher in order to do a better attack. It's really as simple as that. And yeah, that can get pretty damn repetitive. If you look at examples of other brawling titles like classics like Streets of Rage, you think, well, how did they do it? Well, Streets of Rage kind of had a greater variety of moves than a game like this does. They had all sorts of things, including a bunch of grappling attacks, co-op grappling attacks, stuff like that. And it also had weapons pickups, which gave you a different moveset and different attack characteristics. They also had the super special attacks and things like that, depending on which version of Streets of Rage you were playing. So that helped a decent amount. And Streets of Rage wasn't... It was 2D, but it wasn't entirely 2D. They did it on separate planes, so you could actually go into the foreground, into the background, things like that. So that's how they kept the variety up in a game like Streets of Rage. And there are other games where variety was actually a bit of a problem, right? Something like Castle Crashers, for instance, had very little attack variety. The variety in that game came from the crazy set pieces and mini games and the differences in the fights. And also from the fact that there are a lot of different characters available. So even though one character didn't have much attack variety, you could switch out to another character and you could do different things. You could also pick up different weapons. Admittedly, you were still doing the same attacks with those weapons for the most part. And that was definitely a weakness of the title. And then you have a look at a game like this and you think, well, you know, is it acceptable to have a game where the majority of it just seems to be hammering the J button? And my answer to that is yes, because of the crash attacks. Yeah? The crash attacks are that cool, as demonstrated, that they make up for that. Because really, J is just a means to an end, yeah? Hammering that rapid attack is a means to an end to build that bar up so you can unleash something awesome. And it's not just a case of hammering the crash button and hoping for the best. You do have to be a hell of a lot more careful with it than you might think, simply because to get the best impact out of it, you've got to aim it. And it also encourages you to juggle in midair in order to keep your combo going and stop the enemy from attacking you. So there's a bit more depth underneath it than you might initially expect. I still think some people are going to get very, very bored of hitting that J button over and over again and just doing nothing but fighting enemies. But I like brawlers. I'm about to die, by the way. But I like brawlers a lot. And I can kind of accept that lack of attack variety simply because the way that all the systems interplay together and the way that the mechanics work together is actually quite crisp and has that surprising amount of hidden depth. The timing of the attacks is very important in a game like this. You've got to make sure that, especially in mid-air, that you are connecting in the right way at the right angle to allow you to continue a juggle combo or whatever. When you do a crash attack, you want to make sure you do it for maximum impact against the most amount of enemies possible. And that takes a certain degree of practice because the game doesn't have anything like a lock-on. So you really have to know exactly where your opponent's going to bounce, how to best follow them up as quickly as possible. This is extremely true in boss fights as well, I might add. And that actually works out pretty well. The first boss fight I had to attempt, I think, 12 times in order to beat it, which was surprising. I thought, oh, you know, the first boss fight shouldn't be too much of a problem. It was actually quite tricky. He had a number of different attacks and phases. It was a good amount of design put into that boss that actually made him challenging but not unfair, which is another thing that this game does really, really well. It never actually feels unfair. Even when you get to ludicrous levels of enemies and projectiles on the screen, dodge is so powerful that you can get away with it. You can dodge pretty much anything in the game if you got the timing right. And that's what makes the game have a good skill ceiling to it. Means you're learning the various different attack patterns of each enemy, and then you're dodging at the right time, you're trying to counter at the right time, you're figuring out, well, when is the best time that I can unleash a really dangerous combo? Like, oh, well, not that time is the answer to that. I was trying to follow up with a crash attack there, and then he just smacked me with his shield, so, you know, might sound like crash attack is the way to just win every fight, but if you're not precise with it, well, you tend to get your ass kicked. The aerial aspect is quite interesting as well. I like the fact that they've included a huge amount of aerial combat in the game because it makes juggling more satisfying, I feel. It makes a lot more sense for it to be happening in the first place. And it also just introduces an entire new dynamic to juggling because you're aiming to send the enemy further and further into the air in a specific direction so you can then do a follow-up, which you then have to carefully aim. When you hold that button down like that, when I'm doing a crash attack, it's going in a particular direction. If I lose control of it, I'm going to drain my wild bar, I'm going to miss and leave myself open to a counterattack. Now, I think you've probably noticed that I am having certainly a decent amount of fun with this so far. Do I have any problems with it? Well, aside from the whole, you know, J can get very repetitive thing, which I pretty much explained away by the fact that J is kind of a means to an end to execute those really cool crash and charge crash attacks. I do have certain issues with the art design in general. The animation quality is really, really good, yeah? It's got that hand-drawn style to it, and it feels pretty good to move around, and it's important to have good animation if you want to have extremely satisfying brawling. Because if you don't have good animation, you're simply not going to have that. You know? See a game like the Ass Kickers or Fist Puncher as a good example of games that don't really have good quality animations and as such have less satisfying brawling attached to them. But the art style in general is not that inspired. The backgrounds in particular are rather disappointing. I mean, this is just a warehouse, so there's a lot of grey. The first level was... It was mostly on a bridge and in a construction yard, and the background was a very generic looking city with a blue sky. It wasn't particularly inspired, I've got to say. And games like Streets of Rage, the classics of the genre, they may be old, but their graphic style is timeless, you know, because there was a lot of creativity put into that, and the color palette was absolutely fantastic. Yeah, maybe not so much. The backgrounds don't look that great. Overall, I don't think the character design is that amazing either. You kind of got generic-looking ninjas. Your main character is very generic-looking as well. There's nothing that really stands out to me outside of the giant Shiba Inus that you're expected to fight at certain points that really says to me, yeah, you know what? This game really has it going on when it comes to its aesthetic. It doesn't. However, I think it can get away with it on the basis that there's so much going on the screen at any given time, you don't really have much of a chance to actually admire or criticize the aesthetic at all, because you're mostly just punching it in the face over and over and over again. And you're seeing all sorts of... I wouldn't call them particle effects. What would you call those, actually? When you have those impact effects that are very over-exaggerated, they're almost Japanese, maybe anime in nature... I'm not really sure what you call that, but it looks damn good, and it's very, very satisfying to cause a lot of them to appear, as I think you've probably figured out at this point. So, it's a bit of a problem. I'd also say, while the music is okay in places, it's got a pretty decent chiptune soundtrack, it is a little repetitive, to say the least. Oh, we get into a boss fight? What the hell? Alright, okay, this is going to be interesting. So, we have ourselves a boss fight here. The bosses do have their own themes, which is very nice. And they're tough, too. I wonder if this... Actually, I'm not sure if this is... No, it's not an individual boss theme. I think it's just generic boss theme. So this was the same as the Shiba Inu fight that I did on stage one. Which I probably should show you, because you're thinking, what the hell, Shiba Inu fight? Are you serious? Oh, yes. Oh, yes. I wouldn't joke about such things. Absolutely not. Yeah, so the music can get pretty repetitive, I gotta say. Admittedly, that's an easily solved problem. You can just turn the music off and put your own on. But you should still criticize it because it's part of the game. It's really as simple as that. Now, some people will definitely get bored by this quite quickly. I think that's a problem with quite a few brawlers because they really are just about punching people. Some people require more variety in their gameplay. But for those of you that particularly like score attack style gameplay and games that really punish you for mistakes and reward you for great play, then Aces Wild really has it going on in that respect. Everything that you do right in this game feels great, and the game goes out of its way to tell you how awesome you are. Which is something that not enough games do, I think. So that's something to consider there. The dodging feels really, really slick. It's kind of overpowered, but in the same aspect, you can't just spam it, because if you do, then you will lose. I mean, it's as simple as that, because the dodge does have a slight cooldown on it, so you can be caught completely off guard. If you land that perfect charge attack, it feels awesome. Absolutely fantastic. And those are the moments that I'm looking for in games like this. I want to be rewarded for pulling off some amazing combo. And this game has that. The combos may just consist of two buttons, but making them connect in the optimal fashion is surprisingly difficult. It may not have 60, 100 different combos and moves like something like, say, God of War might, but it's still satisfying to play. They may have boiled it down to its essence, but I don't think it's lost too much in the boiling process. In fact, I think they may have brought out a very distinct flavor in doing so. I actually had a lot of fun with this so far. It gets frustrating, but it's not because the game is imbalanced. It's not because the game is unfair. It's actually just because I'm bad. It's really as simple as that. And that's fantastic. I love any game that can make me feel that way. I just want to try that boss again because I know it was my fault. It wasn't the boss's fault. It wasn't some BS that the game pulled that I couldn't have seen coming. I'm just terrible, and I need to be less terrible. And when I do get less terrible, when I do beat a boss, it feels amazing. And brawlers do that pretty well, for the most part. And this one in particular is minimal on the bullshit. Is the price right, you might ask, for the amount of content that's on offer here? How, I mean, you could probably beat this game in a couple of hours if you're really good. It took me 30 minutes to beat the Shiba Inu boss fight, for God's sake, but that's because I'm terrible. So, better players could certainly beat it a lot quicker. Does it have replay value? Yes, in the terms of the score attack and in terms of the variety of difficulty levels and the fact that there's three different characters that do certainly play differently. They feel differently. They've got their own movesets, so that's pretty cool. But yeah, you know, I'd say there's replay value in it. And for $10, I think it's perfectly justifiable to say, yeah, you know what, this game is actually worth the asking price and it's worthy of your time. And when you do stuff like that, it feels amazing. Still got my ass kicked, but never mind. Let's show you the Shiba Inu boss fight, because that's exactly what you want to see. Thankfully, it does let you just go right to the boss area. So we're going to do the Shiba Inu boss fight. I'm going to do it with a different character to show you what's going on with that. And then I'll show you the ridiculous difficulty level. So this guy has a sword. I think he attacks slightly quicker, but he has a little bit more range, a little bit more power on his attacks. So behold the Shiba Inu boss fight. This is Barkley Bones, by the way. And he is going to destroy you, as he always does. He has a variety of different attacks. He's pretty good at what he does. And he's got various phases as well. Also, he... fireballs, of course. Do you not know the Shiba Inu could do that? It can, very much so. There are actually lesser versions of the Shiba Inu that you fight before this, and they seem dangerous enough. You fight one as a mini-boss, you think, oh god, this is hard, and then you get Barkley Bones, who's about five times as difficult as that. So, yeah, there's that. But, again, this is all stuff that you can dodge if you're good and not being distracted by commentary, which I am very much being distracted by, but never mind. Also, he does that, which is quite amusing. I like that. A couple of phases in, he'll also spawn multiple dogs. So, why the hell not? But, yeah, it's got some good boss fights. I actually enjoy it an awful lot. Ah, more dogs. There we go. Alright, let's show you the ridiculous difficulty level, shall we? Yeah, let's go all the way up to maximum difficulty, which is Maximus. There we go. Cool. Interesting, there's actually an exit button here, but not under set resolution. That's a little bit weird. That was that complaint that I was having earlier with the navigation of the menus. It's still dodgy that you can't do them with your mouse, but never mind. Alright, okay. Maximus difficulty. Let's go on to gallery. This is going to get really unpleasant really fast. Alright, here we go. Can I last more than 5 seconds on this? Unlikely. Unlikely. Oh, God. It's definitely got some bullet hell stuff going on with the attacks coming across the screen there. God, Jesus, why? No! Oh, help! This was a mistake! That was a mistake. Good God. Yeah, it's pretty good, honestly. For the price... Absolutely. If it was more expensive than that, I'd definitely have my reservations, because at the end of the day, it is just about punching people. But it's very good at punching people. Yeah? It's very good at punching people. And while the rapid attacks may certainly be repetitive, I think you'll be able to get over it with the combination of the charge attacks and the dashing, and the counter attacks on the dodge and things like that. Yeah. It's not too shabby. Very much a throwback arcade-style brawler. With some nice little mechanics and a good focus on the aerial gameplay, which I feel is satisfying and rewarding. And check it out on Steam, folks. It goes by the name of Aces Wild. And it currently costs $10, I believe. Yes, it's about 10% off on the sale on the first week, but after that it will cost $10 or your regional equivalent, which I think is a pretty reasonable price for a rather good time. My name has been Total Biscuit. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you next time.